Let's have a meal. Let me reveal who I am. I'm your savior. I will kneel down, wash all the sin from your soul. I'm your servant. I am all you need. I'm the lamb that was slain, and my blood washes you clean. I'm the pure sacrifice. Let my life give you life. I'm the lamb. I am the bread given for every man. I sustain you. Drink from the cup. It is my blood shed for all. Redemption. I am all you need. I am everything. I'm the lamb that was slain, and my blood washes you clean. I'm the pure sacrifice. Let my life give you life. I'm the lamb.
You are. Grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Yeah.
Good morning. My name is Cindy Preston, and I'm here to welcome you. It's my pleasure to be here today and to have you here with us, either here in the sanctuary or watching at home online. We're thankful our technology is working, and that's an option. So, as I thought about what to say, I thought it's been a year that we've been dealing with the not normalcy of COVID-19 in our midst. And what I'm missing is the fellowship of church. So, thankfully, some of us are here together, but some of us are still not comfortable being here. So, we're encouraging us as church members to reach out and keep in touch. Think about those people you would normally chat with after church or would have normally chatted with a year ago, and maybe send an email or a phone call or leave a text message on Facebook or on their phone. It's important that we still have a sense of community. I also was hoping that I would be able to tell you today that we had an interim contract in place. We don't. But we have a top candidate who has promised to give us a yes or no answer by the end of today. So please keep that process in your prayers. It's been long and tedious, and we are hopeful for a yes, but as we all know, nothing is final until the contract is signed. So personnel meets Tuesday, and hopefully we will have a contract at that point. Continue to, like I said, keep that everybody in that process, session, personnel, the ad hoc committee, and the potential candidates in your prayers. We all look forward to being able to welcome an interim. That being said, we are incredibly grateful to have Pastor Bert as our pre-interim. And I would encourage you to prepare your hearts and minds for worship as he leads us in the call.
One more quick announcement, just a minor correction to the bulletin in the calendar section, indicates that next week we will have communion, and we will not. We will do it today. So join me in the call to worship. The cross.
We shall take it.
The bread.
We shall break it.
The pain.
We shall bear it.
The joy.
We shall share it.
The gospel.
We shall live it.
The love.
We shall give it.
The light.
We shall cherish it.
The darkness.
God shall perish it.
Change our hearts this time. Your words say as it can be. Change our minds this time. Your life could set me free. We are the people your call set apart. Lord, this time, change our hearts.
Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Heart, O God, may I be like you. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. Thank you.
take a moment in silent confession. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. When our prayers are more than pious words, when we truly open ourselves, when we are truly seeking forgiveness, God becomes a guiding presence, and we are healed, and we are set free.
My soul, my Savior God, to
Friends, believe in the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Reveal to us once more the power and glory which claims us all. Let your word make its impact within and among us, that we may accept your mission for us and enlist all our efforts in watchful service. Come to reign among us and rule in every heart. Gospel lesson this morning is a familiar one from Luke chapter 24. Now, on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" And they replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that indeed, they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, you foolish, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah would suffer these things and then enter into the glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures." As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to them. And then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us, that same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the word of our Lord. Yes, I know this is an Easter text and we are a few weeks early. But the invitation to communion that comes out of this text, and so that's why we're going to deal with it today. Each of the Gospels tells the story a little bit differently. In Luke's telling, we miss something that we have come to expect on Easter morning. Mary Magdalene, she's there. A couple apostles are there. An angel is there. But no Jesus. We don't meet the risen Lord until Easter evening out on the road. The first encounter is with two followers. They're out on the road to Emmaus, but they're not able to recognize him until they break bread together. Let's follow them out on the road. It's a beautiful Sunday afternoon, 60, 65 degrees in Jerusalem, nice, beautiful spring day. The followers have left Jerusalem and they're headed back to the small village of Emmaus. It's a good long walk, 7 miles. The two are talking about all the things that they've seen and all the things that they've experienced during Holy Week. And then we get this saddest of all comments. "We had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel." They crucified him. So obviously, he was not the one. He wasn't the warrior Messiah that we were hoping for. And then suddenly a stranger comes from behind and says, "What y'all talking about?" And they wonder what planet this guy's been from. Seems really quite ironic to me that they're going to tell Jesus what happens, kind of like he wasn't there. And so Jesus, oh, he hears enough. And so he takes over the conversation. Y'all don't get it. And so he interprets the scriptures, the Old Testament, what we would call the Old Testament, and we get a masterclass in biblical interpretation. Starting to get late, everyone's hungry, tired. They're coming into Emmaus, but Jesus kind of heads on. They say, wait, stay with us. And so he says, fine. And then again at the dinner table, Jesus takes the initiative, he takes over. He took the bread, blessed it, broke it, and gave it. You see, Luke is making a point here. Jesus is the one who always takes the initiative, who's always taking the first step toward us. As they received the bread from him, they recognized the risen Christ. That's important. Jesus offers himself. He's offering a relationship. He's offering blessing. He says to them, "You are mine." And then as we all receive his gifts, we recognize the Messiah in our midst. So let's fast forward just a little bit in time. Let's pay attention to what Luke is telling us. First of all, he's making a point that word and sacrament, they go together. out on the road, Jesus sets the stage by interpreting Scripture. And then he is further revealed in the breaking of bread. There's something uniquely revealing, coming right here at the table. We experience Jesus' self-giving. We experience his table fellowship. We experience his grace, his forgiveness, his all-inclusive community. You see, the sacraments are important. That's why we have the table and the font here right in front as we worship. Matthew, Mark, and Luke. In each of those Gospels, the Last Supper is on Maundy Thursday, and it's a Passover meal, an Exodus meal. God sent Moses to confront Pharaoh and say, "Let my people go." God heard the cries of his people, and then he did something about it. He liberates his people, liberates them from oppression and bondage. So you might ask, I certainly ask, who are God's people? The standard and obvious question is, God's people are the sons and daughters of Abraham. I think I would want to go even a little further. The people of God are the ones who sing the blues, those who cry out their pain. God hears the cries of the poor. He welcomes us as we offer our ashes, our failures, and our shortcomings. You see, the mission of God is to redeem God's people from the power of separation and the power of death. The mission of God is to pull together one united family into the kingdom. It's a community of the whole, where none, absolutely none, are excluded. All are included. All ages, all classes, all races, all nationalities, all. Now, the church has been blessed by a variety of invitations to the Lord's table. I want to highlight two of them today. Now, the invitation that I use most often is that they will come from the east and west, from the north and south, to sit at table in the kingdom of God. The imagery here, the symbolism here, extremely important. You see, we're converging north, south, east, and west. We're coming from the corners into the center. The table symbolizes the center of the kingdom. The king reigns from the center. See, the center is sacred space. The center, that's powerful, transformative symbolism. You see, the center is the stage, the place for healing and transformation. And it's at the center that we are most tangibly in God's presence. At the center, we are grounded. At the center, we gain our sense of identity, we gain a sense of direction, and a sense of meaning. At the center, we receive a blessing. We find stability. You see, this table is the symbolic center of all creative and saving power. God calls, and we meet on sacred ground, the center of grace. At the table, Christ opens his arms to welcome us in. He blesses us. He feeds us. And then as we repeatedly gather, month in and month out, as we repeatedly gather, we become more and more Christ-like. When we understand the table, when we understand the sacrament in this way, I can't hardly imagine coming to the table too often. I can't imagine coming to the table and having that ever become a routine in anything that is anything other than absolutely special. You see, if we do our work, if we attend to the liturgy, if we pay attention to the symbolism on the way to the table, it can never become routine. Now let's look at another commonly used invitation to the table. Come to me, all who labor and are heavily burdened, and I will give you rest. And then he says, I am the bread of life. Those who come to me shall not hunger, and those who believe in me shall never thirst. Come to the table, all of you who are tired. Come to the table, all who mourn. Come to the table, all of us who need healing, all who need to be refreshed. Come to the table and I will give you rest. And you will be healed. As we respond to Christ's invitation, we experience God's saving power and we are healed at the table. Come, all who are heavily burdened, and I will give you rest. Come, all who grieve. Come, all who are burdened, all who have guilt or resentment or shame. Come if you're full of pain, whether it's physical or emotional or spiritual. Come if you have sadness in your heart. Come if you're depressed. Come if you're angry or if you're afraid. Come, especially if you're in doubt. Come if you seek God's mercy. Come, all who wish for the joy of forgiveness. Come, all who are hungry and thirst for righteousness. Come to the very center of the kingdom. Come to the table of plenty. Come to the table of liberation. This is the joyful feast of the people of God. Come, let your eyes be opened. Come and recognize our Lord. Come into the presence of God. Amen. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Shall we pray? Come to the table. We come for an encounter with you, Lord. We come to enjoy your inclusive fellowship, your inclusive community. Jesus took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to us. Jesus gives of himself. As we receive the gift of compassion, we recognize our Messiah. At this table, we enter God's presence. We are welcomed, and we come home. We gather in safety. And so this week, we continue to pray for the healing of our torn world. We continue to pray for COVID relief. We continue to pray for all of those who mourn. Amen. Friends, this truly is the joyful feast for the people of God. They will come from east and west, north and south, to sit right here at this table, at the very center of the kingdom of God. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples in Emmaus, he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them. And their eyes were opened as they recognized him. This is our Lord's table, and our Savior invites all who trust in him to come and share the feast that he has prepared for us. Pray with me. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. In sending Christ, the light of the world, you revealed your glory to the nations. And so we lift our hearts in joyful praise. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. In Jesus, your word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus knew both joy and sorrow. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, opened the eyes of the blind, proclaimed the good news of the kingdom. He brought the light that is never overcome by darkness. And so we proclaim the mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon all of us. Pour out your Spirit upon these gifts. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ. And then send us out into the world as the body of Christ. We pray together as we were taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. On that night of his arrest, he took the bread, he blessed it, and then he broke it, and he gave it to them and said, "This is my body. Take and eat. And every time you eat, remember me." The bread of life. In the same way, he took the cup. And he said to them, "This cup is the new covenant revealed in my blood. Whenever you drink of it, remember me, the cup of salvation. Please join me in the prayer after communion. Lord, you have given yourself to us.
Now we give ourselves.
Your love makes us a new people.
As a people of love, we will serve you with joy.
Your glory fills our hearts.
Help us to glorify you
in all things. Amen. Bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord be present and bring you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.
Let's have a meal. Let me reveal who I am. your Savior. I will kneel down, wash all the sin from your soul. I'm your servant, I am all you need. I'm the lamb that was slain, and my blood washes you clean. I'm the pure sacrifice, let my life give you life. I'm the Lamb. I am the bread given for every man. I sustain you. Drink from the cup. It is my blood shed for all. I'm redemption. I am all you need. I am everything. I'm the Lamb that was slain, and my blood washes you clean. I'm the pure sacrifice, let my life give you life. I'm the Lamb. We cry worthy, we cry worthy, we cry worthy is the Lamb of God. We cry worthy, we cry worthy, we cry worthy is the Lamb of God. We cry worthy, we cry worthy, we cry worthy is the Lamb of God. We cry worthy, we cry worthy, we cry worthy is the Lamb of God. You're the Lamb that was slain, and your blood washes us clean. You're the pure sacrifice, let your life give us life. You're the Lamb.
Amen.
Oh, I didn't know if we were only doing that.